Thank you. Friends, welcome to worship. We're delighted that you're here. This is worship with the First Baptist Church Ann Arbor, and with all the rest of you who are joining us from whatever communities, wherever you are. Thank you for being here. In these recent days, when we can't be in the same space together, there seem to have been some losses in the experience of worship. But we have found some great benefits as well in worshiping in this way together, unseen to each other, but powerfully united together. We are here for the purpose of worship. We're glad that all of you are here.
I'm Stacy, and this is Paul, and we're the pastors of First Baptist Church. I want to share a few short announcements with you. The details of all of these will be found in the description of this video, the notes that go with this worship service. The first of these is that we would like to invite you to sign in. Let us know that you're out there. Let us know that you are here with us and how you're joining us, where you are joining us from. And you can follow the link to do that sign-in in the what they call the show notes, the video description. Secondly, I want to let you know about a ministry opportunity, a service opportunity. A month ago, we welcomed into our church facilities an emergency overflow homeless shelter, offering safe, hospitable space to roughly 25 guests who had nowhere else to go during the day or the night. So our space became their home. This was made possible specifically because our facilities are currently closed for worship and for other gatherings and business. So this was actually one beautiful gift to come out of this difficult time, was that we were able to offer this sort of hospitality and shelter to those who needed it. This past Wednesday, those guests moved out of the church and into the Red Roof Inn, where they will now each be able to have their own bedroom and bathroom, a much more comfortable option and a safer option in terms of being able to keep physical distance from each other. We're so glad for them that they're now in a better, more hospitable place even for them. But they actually still need our help. The state provides 3 meals a day for them, but the portions are actually quite small. Pastor Sarah at Trinity Lutheran Church here in Ann Arbor has invited local churches to join with her church to help in providing additional snacks or a protein-rich fourth meal. In the notes for this video, in the description of the video, you will find a link to a sign-up genius so that you can see exactly what is needed for these snacks or fourth meals, and other ways you can help to serve in this way. The more people who pitch in, the lighter workload it is for all. It's so exciting to be able to continue to serve, to minister during a time when we otherwise feel kind of powerless. There are and will be additional opportunities for ministry, for service. If you want to make sure you receive updates about those sorts of things and other news about congregational life, including worship opportunities, follow the link in the video notes to sign up for our church newsletter and eConnection. And of course, you can also check our Facebook page for announcements. Finally, I want to let you know about our annual church program meeting, which ordinarily happens in April and in person. But this year it is going to happen 2 weeks from today, Sunday, May 31st. We will be gathering via Zoom for our annual meeting at 11 o'clock. So following our worship service, we will gather via Zoom. At this meeting, we receive annual reports, we elect officers and board members, And this year, this time, we will be spending the bulk of our time together discussing our church's plans for a phased-in approach to reopening our church facilities and resuming in-person gatherings. You can find the information, the specific details about coming, joining that meeting via eConnection and upcoming church newsletter. So again, you can sign up for those in the link in the notes. Now we invite you to join us in our responsive call to worship. The God who made the world and everything in it.
The God who is Lord of heaven and earth.
Does not live in shrines made by human hands.
Indeed, God is not far from each one of us.
In God we live and move and have our being.
In God we live and move and have our being.
So now, in our living, in our moving, in our very beings, let us worship the Lord God of heaven and earth.
Praise the Lord.
A reading from the Book of Psalms. Praise our God, all peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard. Come and hear, all you who fear God. Let me tell you what he has done for me. I cried out to him with my mouth. His praise is on my tongue. If I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But God has surely listened and has heard my prayer. Praise be to God, who has not rejected my prayer or withheld his love from me. The word of the Lord.
In our gospel reading today, we hear Jesus say, If you love me, follow my commandments. Commandments. That's like following the directions, knowing the expectations, and meeting them. At my house, and maybe at your house where you kiddos are also learning, I wonder if you've been having conversation about what the directions are or what's expected of you. We've been wondering about that at my house. It's trickier to understand that when you're trying to learn over the computer all the time. Jesus says, if you love me, you will follow my commandments. You will meet my expectations. We know that the two greatest commandments are these: love God and love others. Love God and love others. If you love me, Jesus says, you will do these things: love God and love others. Children, I know you've been thinking about that. We started thinking about it last week. And thinking about the decisions we have to make. We're always thinking about the choices we make so that we do those things, loving God and loving others. In a little bit, you'll hear from the children. They'll be sharing with you the ways they are trying to do their best to be followers of Jesus because they do love him. And we know that we always have God's help. It's not easy to be a follower all the time. It's a lot of hard work and careful decision making, and sometimes it's not so clear what the right decision is or the right choice. So we always have God's help, and we hear that in today's reading too. We have an advocate, the Holy Spirit, to help us. It makes me think of that song that Miss Coley sang for us earlier, that prayer, God be in my head, be in my eyes, be in my mouth, be in my ears, be in and through me, God, so that I may see and think and understand and speak and listen as you do. With God's help, we can do these things. We can love God well with all of our being, and we can love our neighbors as ourselves. I hope that you now enjoy hearing from the children as they share with you their love for Jesus, the careful decisions they're trying to make, remembering that God is always with us, helping us.
Hi, I'm Annie. I love Jesus, so I help my siblings when they need help. God helps me.
Hi, I'm Alice. I love Jesus, so I try not to yell at my sister that much.
I'm Asher. I love Jesus, so I try to take turns with my brother. God helps me.
Hi, I'm Ingrid. I love Jesus, so I help him and I love him.
Hi, my name's Lucas. Love Jesus, so I give hugs. God helps me.
Hi, I'm Piper. I love Jesus, so I share with people. God helps me.
Hi, I am E. I love Jesus, so I help others when they need it. God helps me.
Hi, I'm Teresa. I love God, so I try to include everyone when I play. God helps me.
Will you pray with me? Ever living God, ever loving God, by your power, you created us. By your love, you redeemed us. By your Spirit, you continue to guide and strengthen us. You are life and new life. You are goodness and grace. You are mystery and more than we can imagine. You are beyond us and also with us. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we need you. In these moments of our highest praise and worship, we come before you with our deepest hurts and fears. We are struggling. Our world is struggling. We are staggered by the enormity of pain, suffering, fear, failings, rage. We feel powerless. We are sad. We feel afraid. We are tempted towards despair. We cannot fix all of this, but we ask you to renew our hope, to renew our imagination, to renew our sense of your power already at work in us, to do the good we can do, to offer the love we can offer, to take the actions we can take, even when they seem too small and insignificant. Help us to trust in the slow work of your Spirit within us and among us. As we try to trust you, so now we give you all the concerns and needs and fears that feel far too big for us to handle. We pray for our communities, our nation, and our world. We pray for healthcare workers, the healthcare system, the healthcare supply chain. We pray for the economy, for the unemployed, the underemployed, the furloughed, for those facing economic uncertainty, for essential workers who are put at risk. We pray for small business owners and for leaders and decision makers at all levels. We pray for the sick, the dying, the grieving. We pray for students, especially for those who are graduating without getting the kind of celebration and closure they need. We pray for educators, especially for those who are retiring without getting the kind of celebration and closure they need. We pray for parents with school children at home. We pray for those who do not have adequate shelter or food or safety, and for all who are trying to help them and advocate for them. We pray for the Poor People's Campaign. We pray for the church in all places. We pray for your good creation and for the will to take care of it. And we also pray specifically for those we know to pray for by name. For Elena Rosario and her family in the death of her grandmother, Maria Luna. For Maria Pierantozzi, Joan and Lynn Blunt, Marilyn Marsh, Juanita Dieterle, Iris Martin, Danny Jones, John Rapson, Robert L., Nick Dodson, Jill Damon, Don Middleton, Rob Snyder, Alexandra Carr, Jessica Leal, and Javier Castro. In darkness and in light, in trouble and in joy, help us, gracious God, to trust your love, to accept your grace, and to serve your purpose. We pray all these things in the strong name of Jesus, who taught us how to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now a reading from the Gospel of John. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another companion to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth. whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphans. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you will live. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune thy heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let that grace now like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
And now in these words spoken and received, may a living word come to us and do its good work within us and between us and among us. Amen. There is no time like a pandemic to reassess yourself. A time like this can expose us to ourselves in a way that we don't normally observe. So much that we're used to blows up. Our time, our space, our sense of the future, our schedules, our locations, our human contact, it crumbles down around us and there we are, exposed. So this is who I am. My new situation gives me new opportunity to see in myself what I may not have been in a position to notice before. Which is to say that for all the chaos and the disgust and the anxiety that may swirl within us and all around us in this time, it turns out to be an opportune time to listen to your life. Is my life right? Is it mostly right? My relationships, my behaviors, and my frame of mind, how healthy are they? Or are they filled with distortions and contradictions? It's true that all human beings carry some of that, but the truth is also that to be growing toward wholeness is to have fewer contradictions, fewer distortions, to have less falsehood, less hypocrisy, less of the inner-outer warfare. On the night before he died, Jesus spoke to this in a way. He was talking to his baffled friends and gave them some assurances and some instructions, one bit of which was this: if you love me, keep my commandments. You can hear that. Let your actions be consistent with what your heart truly knows. Let outward and inward be aligned. Let your words and your habits of mind and your commitments to the world and to God and to yourself be in harmony with each other. For most of us, that is a lot to ask. It sounds simple enough. The love of Christ within us means living the laws of Christ wherever and however we can. But the truth is that humans by nature are given to inconsistencies, and we are specialists in compartmentalizing our values, behaviors, feelings, beliefs. Most of us would say our lives are less a harmony and more like a jangle. Here's a picture for it. Like many of you, my new life is filled with Zoom meetings and gatherings online of a screen filled with faces of each one in its own box. It's a wonderful thing to get to do this. It's also really weird. And now imagine that you're opening your eyes to such a screen, and there are all those faces in all those boxes, only each one of them this time is you. Only each with a different expression, different gestures, different tone. So in one of them, it's clear you are smiling and nodding. In another, you are expressing a firm opinion. In another, you're shaking your fist with rage. In another, you're sobbing into your hands. In another, you're clearly frightened of something. In another, you're hunched over like a gargoyle, whatever that means. And in yet another, you have actually escaped your box and gone to another and punched yourself in the face. And Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Is he asking from us more consistency than we're really capable of? It helps if we refuse to forget who it is who speaks these words. On the one hand, Jesus really is the scourge of hypocrisy. He is magnificently intolerant of people who display piety, but in fact are unjust, negligent of the poor, and pushing away those whom they designate as the sinners, the outsiders. He calls them whitewashed tombs, a fine exterior on an inner stench. But that same Jesus, who was speaking against hypocrisy when he said, if you love me, keep my commandments, is also the one who was always forgiving and encouraging those who tried and failed. Jesus specialized in making friendship with the compromised. He knew brokenness, and it was to the brokenness, to the broken ones, that he said, if you love me, keep my commands. He said it as a physician would. And because he's the one who said it, we know there's tenderness in it and mercy for it when we try, but we fail. And what is that commandment of his? Here's an interesting thing. Jesus in the Gospels never ever uses the word commandment of what he says, except for once. And he has just done it in the moment before he speaks the words we've been listening to today, when he said, "This is my new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." That's the word still hanging in the air when he says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." Personally, I'm for keeping all his other mandates too. I think we're meant to. And they include, forgive your enemies. Give of your possessions to the poor. Feed the hungry, welcome the stranger, keep your marriage vows, keep at your prayers. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself, and do not hinder the children. Aren't these his commandments too? And we are to keep them. And still, when he said to his friends, "Keep my commandments if you love me," what he had just told them is, "This is my command, that you love each other." That is his insistence on the integrity of our love. A harmonized love that, as we have regarded Jesus, we will in the same way regard each other, a love indivisible. And because that is not always easy for us, because we don't always know how to love, Jesus said, "I will give you help. Yes, I am leaving, but I am not leaving you orphaned. I will send to you another companion, the Spirit of Truth." This is Jesus' first naming of the Holy Spirit, and what an amazing way of naming it this is. Your companion, the Spirit of Truth. This is the Spirit that will help you know what is real and what isn't, what matters and what doesn't. The Spirit of Truth will help you be truthful. It will help you understand what matters to your living, what matters to your speaking and to your listening. The Spirit of Truth will empower you to know what is true and will lead you to integrity in yourself and in community. "I will rise and give you the Spirit. It will be the Spirit of Truth." I can't think of a more relevant word, can you? In our time and place, is anything more needed than more people who know truth, discern truth, speak truth, and live truth? And more communities of such people growing and growing, becoming brighter and brighter in their witness to the truth. The country is piled high with lies like locusts, blatant deceit and disinformation, false claims, false values, false accusations. I mustn't be too grim about us, as we have all been awestruck lately by beautiful, massive displays of kindness all around us. But the truth is that sometimes being kind is easier than being honest. Honest about ourselves and about the evils that are all around us. Honest about what is good. Honest, too, about who is suffering the most now and why and what we are to do about it. Because part of what it means to have the truth in ourselves is to forsake indifference. It is the spirit of truth that makes us free. Jesus said it, you will know the truth and the truth will make you free. Long ago, I saw a game show in which a contestant had to supply the last word in that sentence. His category was great quotations, and he was given, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you." And he said, "Rich?" I like Flannery O'Connor's version better. She said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you odd." Jesus, of course, said it best, the truth makes you free. Free now to say, this is who I am, imperfect, broken, flawed, beloved, forgiven, blessed, empowered, joined to a great community of God's children. Free to get better, free to forgive, free to risk, free to care, even when caring can hurt. Free to be unintimidated and to be a voice in the world and to say what I know. Free also to say I don't know, when that's the truth of it, because we do not have the whole truth. The truth is bigger than what our minds can hold or what our systems can give us. And most of all, God is vastly more than our minds can begin to imagine. So part of our truth is our dumbfoundedness. We can confess that and a great deal more that needs to be confessed. And we are free to love God and to love the world and to love each other with absolute abandon, and so to give ourselves to a new obedience to the great life-giving, sweet commandment of Jesus. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Has not left us, but has come to breathe within us, upon us, between us, among us, the spirit of truth. That is our freedom. It is our courage, our hope. It is our integrity at last. And it is our never, ever ending Easter. Alleluia. And amen.
I will never leave you, orphan. Jesus, you once told your own. When we're overwhelmed and frightened, show us that we're not alone. Thank you for the Holy Spirit, who is present every day, giving love that we might share it, giving us the words to say. In affliction we find comfort, through our friend and help and guide. When we're sad and cannot bear it, you are with us by our side. Then in comfort we find challenge, as you call your church to be, mercy bearers, justice seekers, in your new community. Christ, in comfort and in challenge, may the church hear what you say. I will never leave you, orphan. trust your word today. Then in comfort we find challenge, as you call your church to be. Mercy bearers, justice seekers, in your new community.
Part of what it means to keep the gracious commandments of Christ always is to offer what we can of who we are and also of what we possess. And so we come now, as always happens in worship, rightfully to a time of offering what we have and who we are. On your screen, you will see four different ways to give financially. We encourage you, as you're able to do that, as in this very different time of our lives, of the nation, of the world. The ministry of the church goes on and needs our support. Let us give in whatever way we can, gladly and in faith.
The peace of Christ be with you.
The peace of Christ be with you.
Peace of Christ be with you.
Peace of Christ be with you.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
Dear friends, Christ is risen and everything is changed. Alleluia.
Live in the world as new creations, for in Christ so you are. Alleluia.
Go from this hour more alive than you have been.
Against all forms of death, be fearless.
In every opportunity for love, be extravagant.
Live in rising joy.
Live in boundless peace.
For the Lord God omnipotent reigns. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.